You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Joining us in Brentwood, California is Dave Sirus. He's written for Saturday Night Live and Triumphing Cell Comic Dog, and he's quickly becoming one of the most popular guests on The David Feldman Show. Hello, Dave Sirus.
Hey, David. How are you?
Well, I just want to go over a couple of things with you, okay?
Okay, yeah.
You know that on this show, I demand loyalty.
Yes, of course. Any good leader does.
All right. So I just want to make sure that you're loyal to the show and you're not loyal to yourself, okay?
Okay. Of course.
Now, you're not trying to suck your own cock, right? You're not trying to build off my brand, on my coattails, are you?
Not since I was 15.
Okay. You're here to serve the podcast, correct?
Yes, yes. I am a patriotic member of the David Feldman Program.
Okay. Because there's some information about the podcast that's getting out that I don't want being leaked. And it's not you, right?
Well, no, no. I would never leak anything. But I imagine that whoever did leak this probably had their heart in the right place and was probably just doing it, you know, for the good of the show.
Well, all right. You're not a paranoid motherfucking schizophrenic, right?
I didn't say that. I'm just saying that sometimes people leak things simply because they maybe think that someone's doing something they shouldn't be, and you're not in a position to fix it, and maybe the authorities could. I'm just saying. It, you know, sometimes leaks, you know, can work out for the best. That's all.
Okay. Obviously, I'm quoting the great Scaramucci, who gave an interview with The New Yorker. And quite frankly, it's the funniest thing I've ever seen in The New Yorker. Compared to Shouts and Murmurs, I have to hand it to Scaramucci. I'm finally laughing at something that's in The New Yorker.
I did study under a New Yorker cartoonist once in college when I was going to college to draw, like do cartoons and stuff. Uh-huh. And it was the most aggressively unfunny experience of my life.
Well, their cartoons are good. It's their Shouts and Murmurs that are just, right?
I'm not a big New Yorker fan. I'm in my 30s.
Yeah. Anyway, so Scaramucci, the mooch, has he started yet? He hasn't even started yet as the communications director for Donald Trump. He's already...
He doesn't start till next month.
Well, he's starting, and he's already given an interview with The New Yorker saying that he's going to destroy Rince Priebus, the chief of staff. If you're...
Yeah.
Is that macho to talk that way, or does that belie insecurity and an inability to deal with pressure? Do we really want people talking that way in the Oval Office? Can you imagine being in the Situation Room with this guy and they're about to kill bin Laden? How
I can't imagine there's
judgment?
A single person there. I don't think anyone there besides Trump wants him there. I can't imagine that's possible. Because we all know why he's there. He's there because Trump thinks that everyone should just be a mirror of himself. He wants Scaramucci because Scaramucci is what Trump sees himself as, a tough guy. And he thinks that that's what toughness is, that's what strength is, being a bully and acting in a way that tells pretty much everyone how insecure you are. I mean, there's no question about that. But that's why I don't think Scaramucci is going to last. I think that Trump is not going to be able to handle someone like him with an ego like his in the White House, because he thinks it's just a he thinks he's a surrogate for Trump, but Scaramucci's there for himself. Scaramucci's just doing what he thinks will get the most attention, like Trump does. And I honestly feel that if you put two Donald Trumps in a room, one would be dead within minutes. he would, if there were two Donald Trumps in a room, one would eat the other one's face off.
Actually, I think I disagree with you. I think he's a bully and I think he's a coward. And both Trumps would walk away from a physical altercation. When he's safe on the phone or behind the bulletproof glass in the Oval Office with Secret Service, he's a tough guy. But mano a mano? No way. No way.
Well, I mean, if he's anything like Trump, which is why he got the job, he's the kind of person who the last thing he would ever want is a fair fight.
Mm-hmm.
This is a man who would do anything to avoid fighting fair. He only wants to pick fights with people who can't fight back or in weaker positions. It's an incredibly insecure position. I mean, we don't have to get into this yet because we want to talk about this also, but I mean, the ban on transgender people and the way that he announced it is a perfect example of Trump's need to bully and to only bully the people he feels are vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
It's why, you know, he seems to get madder at our allies than our enemies, because our enemies might lash out. But our allies are classier than that and say, well, this is just ridiculous. I'm not going to fight. But he wants to, but he'll kiss the ass of the enemy because they can actually spank him. Same with, he picks fights with women more than men. You know, I don't think he's ever been as mad at a journalist as the one who was physically handicapped.
Right.
He likes an unfair fight. He wants to be the only guy with two legs in an ass-kicking contest.
Tell me about the ban on transgender people serving in the military. It's transparent. It's not only a transgender ban, it's a transparent attempt to deflect attention from his incompetence and shore up his ignorant base.
Yeah, and it's a multi-tiered attack here, and each one is dangerous. One, obviously, just because the worse he's doing at the job, the more he feels he needs to just lock down his base. And by attacking something like transgender people serving, and not even a nuanced attack, saying in any capacity, which is a very cruel and sweeping and irrational way of trying to put this across, that shows that he's trying to say, I want to take up the ugliest, most hateful parts of people's minds, because that's the part no one else is willing to go after, and that's going to make them love me the most. When I start telling them that even the darkest, most horrible things you believe are okay to believe, it's very intoxicating. It's almost like that's where he gets this kind of cult-like following. You know, it would be like if he came out and said, you know, there should be, women need to let go of men cheating. Cheating is normal. Every single man does it. Cheating men would think, finally, someone who cares about me. He just wants to latch on to the ugliest parts of people's psyches. That's one part. The mm-hmm. second part is that he's testing the waters. And that's what the most dangerous thing here is. He's seen, well, he's like a toddler testing his boundaries to see how much he can get away with before he does something really, really big. And something like this, to just make a military decree through tweet, not tell anyone, this makes me think that this is someone who's doing this because he's inching closer to just bombing Korea without telling his staff. I'm afraid he's going to find out who the individual who mans that button is, and he'll call them directly.
See, I'm naive. I honestly believe, first of all, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff said they're not going to obey his order to his tweet, his executive tweet, banning transgender people. I think he's going to learn just how denuded of power he actually is when it comes to being the commander in chief. You got a Mad Dog Mattis running the Pentagon. I like to think, and I know this is naive, that these guys know that you cannot obey an order that is against the law.
But would it be against the law for him to attack Korea? Isn't that within his rights as a police action? Does the law allow him to contact a general directly and place an order for that?
Well,
that's what I don't know.
Well, I think you have a little political clout if you're Mattis, and you can say, you know what, I am going to resign instead of following your order.
But that's not even what I'm worried about. I'm worried about, what if Mattis doesn't even know until the bombs are in the air? What if Trump decides I'm going to call personally the guy who actually turns that key?
Don't you think Donald Trump has already pressed that button 6 times already?
And it's not connected to anything.
Uh-huh.
It's like a phone filled with candy that you give to a child.
I think they have like some kind of system set up where every time he presses the red button, the screens in the Situation Room show Korea disappearing and California disappearing, and he goes back to bed and he forgets the next morning. I think they have a little system set up. I have been wrong every step of the way. Every step of the way.
Sure.
Would he attack Korea? Well.
Oh, yeah. Oh, so much.
Do you think he really...
Do
you think he cares about Korea?
Of course not.
I think he cares.
He sees Korea as a convenience.
Yeah. I think he cares more about... I think he's all about settling scores and living in chaos. I think he lives in chaos and enjoys that. You know, Rick Overton once said to me about a person we were working for and with who was out of her mind. And he said, did you ever go to sit down and realize the chair wasn't there and you were about to fall? He said, imagine that moment where you're falling, but you haven't hit the ground yet. That's how she feels all the time. She's in that constant state of falling. And when they're not in that constant state of falling, they're lost. They're going, what's, I don't understand this. Chaos, he's a merchant of chaos because that's all he understands.
Well, of course, that's why he would attack Korea. That would be the most chaotic thing he could do. I think that we're looking at a panic. Just his tweets alone show a panic that is setting in where he's just constantly, he keeps talking about Hillary Clinton and committing crimes. Barack Obama should be arrested. He has this obsession with doing anything you can to change the subject. And we're seeing it on a global scale. There is nothing he's not willing to do because he doesn't like this country. It's not like George W. Bush, who was just misguided and was just wrong about what's right. This is someone who doesn't care what's right. That's what's so much more dangerous about this. I think bombing Korea is the thing he would absolutely do because he needs people to stop talking about him and his crimes. He wants to make it about, you know, I'm protecting you. And he's not above saying, I bombed Korea, and then just making up something about a nuclear bomb that he knew they were going to have, and just, you know, and then because his base will believe him. Even if the CIA and everyone comes out and says this isn't true, they'll just believe it. So he just sort of wants to do whatever he can to stay in power. And I mean, don't we think that that's a little tiny bit of why we went to Iraq? Because George W. Bush, or at least the people in his cabinet, thought, you know, the way to control this country is fear. The way to get reelected is fear.
I think it's a different cranial pathology. I think George W. Bush had his own Oedipal issues. Donald Trump is a malignant narcissist.
Oh, yeah.
I think, listen, I agree with everything you're saying. I'm just trying to be optimistic here. And the way I read Trump is, I've been there. Not on as grand a scale as Donald Trump, but I've been as angry as Donald Trump. I've been as paranoid. And I've also been as pugnacious as Donald Trump. And there's certain people in this world, and maybe you don't understand it. Maybe, you know, I don't, but I can empathize with Trump. I think there are certain people who enjoy the fight, who, you know, you and I have never gotten into a screaming match or an argument. But
right.
there are certain people who love the fight. Have you ever been in a relationship with a woman who thinks part of it is the fight? There are people who yeah. love the fight. It gets their juices yeah. going. I think he gets up every morning the same way a lawyer gets up every morning, or a boxer. He deals with lawyers. He's dealt with boxers. I think he gets up every morning and gets energized by the fight. And he goes to bed at night saying to somebody, I don't, you know, boy, did I show him, huh? Did I show him? And then he forgets it. And the next morning, it's a brand new fight.
Do you really, I know people do you very think, well exactly like that.
Right. Yeah. Do you think he's even considering the executive tweet about transgender people serving in the military? That was a century ago in his brain. He's off to the next fight, right?
Right, and it's important that we don't play by his rules, because he said it, he's owning it, he made a decree, and we have to look at, you know, we don't owe him to assume he's lying about things. He doesn't have the right to say, oh, I was kidding, whenever he doesn't want to get in trouble for something. We should look at what he said and say, well, you have to own this whether you felt it or not. Even if you did it in a fugue state, you still have to take responsibility for it. I mean, let's just look for one second at what he actually said. He said the only reason we're taking transgender people out of the military is because it's too expensive and it's hurting our ability to get ready. It's our preparedness. And, of course, you know how much they said it costs, about $2 million to accommodate the several thousand transgender soldiers, about the cost of one Mar-a-Lago trip, by the way.
Right.
And
by the way, nothing screams preparedness than the Trump administration. If anybody knows yeah. about being prepared, it's Donald
They still
Trump.
Haven't filled up all their other positions. But, I mean... But let's say for a second, yeah, so you're saying it's too expensive, the $2 million, maybe, I don't want to come off too conservative on your show, David, but maybe our military servicemen deserve a little bit more health insurance coverage than the average person. Maybe of everyone in this country whose insurance should cover getting a sex change, it's someone who's risking their life for our freedom.
Right.
Maybe that $2 million should not be looked at as such a hardship. And also, talk about people with a conviction, people who are going to put themselves in harm's way, people with bravery. Who is braver than someone that gets a surgery to turn the dick into a vagina? That is someone that I would never compare myself to in terms of the ability, just, you know, sheer metaphorical balls.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that you cannot get someone tougher than someone who's going to do that. That is a person with extreme conviction. That is a person who deserves a lot of respect, without any question.
You cannot call someone a pussy for deciding to have one.
Yeah. they are risking their ability to even feel pleasure the rest of their lives just because this is who they truly are. You know, and if anyone, I think part of the reason Trump hates trans people is because he's insecure about any man pretending to be someone else.
Mm-hmm.
I think it sticks with him. And also, let's be perfectly honest, he probably had sex with a trans woman in the 80s, you know, considering the way he dated, considering the fact that he would just reach out and grab women's genitals. I think he said grab them by the pussy. I think he said the word pussy to be specific,
mm-hmm.
because at least one time it was a dick.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think there's a lot of bigotry behind this, and he just likes bigotry in and of itself.
Right. Right.
It helps him manipulate the weak.
So the best thing you can do is ignore him. Right?
That's what we should have done in the beginning.
That's what I'm trying to do on this show. I mean, I'm having fun with you, but the rest of the show, well, we are talking about the transgender ban is real. That's an actual thing that the putative commander-in-chief decreed on Twitter, so we have to talk about that. They're also trying to strip Americans. They're trying to kill Americans this week with the skinny
mm-hmm.
bill. There's an article.
Yeah.
There's an article in the New York Times, and they show state by state who is going to lose their insurance if the Affordable Care Act is repealed? And it is suicide. You have a suicidal president, and you have a suicidal electorate who is allowing another vote to strip us of Obamacare, and we sit back and allow this, and it's suicide. How do we allow McConnell and Paul Ryan to murder all these Americans? That what is it, 25 million Americans are at risk right now of losing
something
their health?
Something like that. And they will. But their attitude, to play devil's advocate, their attitude is you shouldn't think of it as millions of people dying. You should think of it as natural selection. I think they see it as, hey, once these people are dead, no more sick people. I mean, it's like waiting for a cold snap to kill the homeless. I mean, I think deep down, they see all the people who Obamacare kept alive as a liability.
Mm-hmm.
I think they look at all those people who are literally alive today because they were able to get free health care and see them as the enemy of the state. They see them as what the Nazis would call a useless eater. People who are depriving all the hardworking people of their work. I think they maybe not admit this to themselves, but you have to kind of acknowledge that that's what you feel when you're so adamant about taking away this health care, and the fact that the worst thing that could ever happen to them was to give Obamacare enough time for the markets to settle and things to become normal like any other country that has any kind of government-sponsored health care.
These are some red states that went for Trump. Texas, 1.8 million Texans will lose their health insurance.
Yep. Let's not forget all the people are going to lose their overtime, too. That's going to hit them, too.
Mississippi, 147,000 are going to lose their health insurance. Arkansas, 232,000 are going to lose their health insurance. Kansas.
And they, David, those people are the bravest ones of all because they're the ones who will die so future generations can live. They are the unfortunate eggs that must be broken for this omelet that is America.
They're the Muhammad Attas. You're absolutely right. They're the ones.
It's not their fault.
No, well, I think they're the suicide bombers. I think the people in Texas, the 138,000 in Iowa who are going to lose their health insurance, they voted for Trump. They're the same thing as Muhammad Atta, the same analog. Muhammad Atta flew a plane into the World Trade Center, killed himself to prove a point. These people in Tennessee, 251,000 people from Tennessee who voted for Trump, they're going to lose their health insurance. But they're making a grander point. You're absolutely right. They're suicide bombers.
I think that they actually believed that their health insurance would get cheaper or free. I think they believed him when he said it's going to be so easy, everyone's going to get covered at a fraction of the cost. I think that as hard as it is for people like us to imagine, there were people in this country who really thought that was true. And it's very sad, and I feel bad for them. But I mean, they're going to be sacrificed on the altar of the lesson that America has to learn about this. Because it's already too late. It's already happening. People are going to die because Trump got elected. No question. And these are the people who are going to have to suffer because of mistakes that a lot of people make. They're not getting rid of their health insurance. They thought they were going to keep it. They just didn't listen. They didn't listen to anyone except him. And he's a Pied Piper who led them off a cliff.
There are these votes all week. Now they're voting on the skinny repeal of Obamacare. And they say that by 2026, if the skinny repeal is passed, 16 million more Americans would be uninsured by 2026. The world is watching. Americans are paying attention to C-SPAN right now to find out whether or not they're going to die. We're waiting on these votes all week. And the Republicans are going to keep the House, and Trump isn't going anywhere because why? Because this country's medicated. We're, you know, they're all taking Zoloft and Lexapro, and
that's a big part of it. Yes.
How do we allow this? How do we allow these Republicans to murder 16 million people? Because it's a death sentence. If you don't have health insurance, it's a death sentence, right?
For many people, yes. And this is simply the bed we've made. And the only way things are going to get better is when people start seeing bodies. Very sad, and I wish it didn't have to be that way. And I wish the power of my jokes alone changed people's minds, but they're not going to. The only people are going to learn anything is when they stop getting their overtime, they stop having health care, when they start seeing people starving as a direct result of the fact that a malignant narcissist is in charge, only then will the tide turn. Will these people recognize what they've done?
What do you mean they? What do you mean they?
The people who voted for Donald Trump.
Yeah, but it's
the people who made this happen.
Right, but it's also people who didn't vote for Trump who are going to suffer.
Yeah, and that sucks because they are not the ones who made the mistake. But this, the horse is already out of the barn. This is going to get ugly. This is going to be bad, and we can't do anything about it because people chose Donald Trump. Extent, obviously, he didn't really choose him, but he won. And enough people voted for him, and enough people still trust in him that we cannot stop this. And we have to sit back and wait for the horrible ramifications of it. I do not see any other way around this.
Are you capable of admitting you're wrong?
About what?
Because
you mean in general?
You think that America is going to learn its lesson. Has it ever learned its lesson?
To an extent, I don't see a lot of people defending the Iraq war anymore. I don't see a lot of people saying that Nixon was proven innocent like they were saying on TV during the trials. I think plenty of times, mostly with the mistakes of Republicans, we see a lot of hand-wringing and it doesn't make as much of a difference as it should. But yeah, we do not... Look at the way the Republican Party abandoned George W. Bush at the end of his term.
Mm. It's not that they admit they're wrong. They stop caring about whether or not they were wrong. Iraq is just forgotten. Nobody says, I was wrong for invading Iraq. They'll say mistakes were made. Vietnam, they say... noble cause, the wrong war for the right reasons. That's what I used to hear. It's the wrong war for the right reasons. No, it was the wrong war for the wrong reasons. I don't think Americans are capable of reflection and admitting mistakes. I just don't think we have it in. I think we just conveniently forget the past. So we don't have to deal with it.
Well, I would answer that with an analogy about the financial crisis of 07. They'd never believed that the financial crisis, the housing crisis could happen because they said, look at all the data. Every time no one has ever gone below 20%, let's say, of paying back their loans. So there's no way all these loans are going to collapse at once. But the problem was, there had never been a time before where so many toxic loans and just completely unusable assets have been bundled like this. So the difference is America's never learned from their mistakes. America has never made a mistake like this. This is on a different level. I don't think we can apply history to the situation because this is insurmountably bigger. Like I said, this is the difference between typical Trump himself. The Trump administration, the incompetence behind it, I don't think is comparable to anything in American history, where I do believe, even if we never learn from our mistakes, this one is so glaring, so ridiculous, that there's no way that this is not going to have the most epic, blowback of in history, because no one has ever played the game he's playing right now. Well, we're not used to someone playing that game. We don't know how to deal with it.
I stand corrected. 43 million Americans will be uninsured by 2026 if the skinny repeal is passed by the House and the Senate, according to the Congressional Budget Office. You say Americans have never experienced anything as epic as this. Did we learn anything from the Civil War?
Well, that's a good question. I wasn't alive to see it. You tell me.
Well, it was epic. It was worse than this. Did we learn anything from the Civil War? Yes, we freed the slaves. We freed the slaves. But did we learn anything? Did the South ever say, you know what? We fought this war because we wanted slavery, and we were wrong. Was there ever truth and reconciliation? No.
No.
They
to this day, they will never admit that they were just trying to hold on to their human property.
Right.
That's true.
They reinvented history and said it was about states' rights, the noble cause.
Yep.
They were trying to protect a way of life. So America fights a civil war to end slavery, and we didn't demand that the South admit it was wrong because Lincoln was shot and the radical Republicans weren't allowed to administer Reconstruction. But, you know, we had segregation and Jim Crow and the Ku Klux Klan. 100 years later, African Americans were certainly better off. But did anybody admit they were wrong? No.
Well, to quote Jon Snow, their punishment was their death, I suppose.
Who's?
Those who fought the Civil War and those who fought for slavery. But that's obviously a pretty hollow win. No, you're right. There is not a lot of learning from the Civil War. But at the same time, you have to look at it and say, have we gotten no better since then? We have. Is it to a level that we should be happy with? No.
Well,
but when Martin Luther King was assassinated, did you see a real difference? Didn't that moment sort of wake up a few white people to sort of sober them up and say, okay, what we're doing is wrong and we have to reevaluate? You know, no one wants it to be that kind of moment, but you know what I'm saying.
Well, since
there are moments like that,
but how many Americans have died from gunshots since 1968, the year that Robert F. Kennedy and Martin Luther King were assassinated? I think it's 2 million Americans have been killed by guns since that happened. I don't know.
Well, we also, in the last 30 years, stopped being a country where every time there's a blackout, people start looting. As a small example, a tiny win. I mean, crime has gone down since the 80s. Probably because of diesel fuel, but still, small wins.
People still loot.
Yeah, but in the 70s, when there was a blackout in Manhattan, people were breaking windows. In the 2000s, when there was a blackout, no one was looting. Just as one example, it's not a lot better, but it's better.
Well,
and
the looting,
I think that Trump is
in the 2000s in New York City, the looting was going on, but it was Wall Street.
Yes, that is true.
That's an applause break. Hang on. I'm just waiting for the applause to die down. Tell me, how is Los Angeles today? We'll wrap it up. How is Los Angeles today?
Oh, it's beautiful. I was just this whole time, in case you heard too much, I was walking through Brentwood. Because I figured to go for a walk, exercise my way through the slog that is doing this show. And it's great. I'm coming home tomorrow for my beautiful cousin Brina's wedding.
Mm.
She is marrying a wonderful woman named Kara. And I'm only bringing it up to let you know how good a person I am.
Oh, you're a good person because you're going to a
gay
wedding.
Because Yes. And I want everyone to know what a man I am, that I'm going to stand. And I'm also, yeah, to be fair, I'm the most liberal person in my family, including the gay ones. So, I'm always looking for points.
Is she Jewish?
Yeah. Oh, the woman she's marrying? I actually don't know, now that you mention it.
Because that can be.
I never asked. Seems weird to hold on to that one, though, once your kid's gay, though, doesn't it?
A lesbian wedding, I think a Jewish parent might be concerned that the daughter's marrying out of the religion. I don't want you eating shellfish.
Hey, I long for a day that equality has gotten so great that a parent will go to their gay child's marriage, their gay child's wedding, and the only thing they'll be bothered by is the race of the bride. That's the kind of,
yes,
of progress I want.
We're getting better as a people, I guess.
Yes.
I don't feel it today.
Hey, look, there you go. Look, gay people, there you go. There's one tiny win we can look at. Look at the win we got with that. Yes. Look how much better it is to be gay in this country than it was in the 90s, for God's sake.
Yes. But that's because
we are capable
of
learning.
Because of the Supreme Court, not because of Congress and not because of President Obama. That's because of the Supreme Court.
It's because of people. It's because people woke up to the fact that these are their friends and family. And I'm not that optimistic a person unless being compared to you. But I just feel like the Trump administration is such a special danger that we're going to be surprised. I think you're right. The Republican Party is going to sweep this disaster under the rug, and in 5 years, they're going to act like Donald Trump's existence was 1,000 years ago, and mm-hmm. they're going to go right back to attacking Democrats on character, and they're going to go right back. But Trump himself will be a pariah or in jail.
I think
at the very least, will return to the hell that it was before Trump.
I guarantee you will be told it's not good for the country. When Ford pardoned Nixon, he said, our long national nightmare is over. And I'm thinking, really? You're not gonna let this guy go to prison? You're not gonna teach anybody a lesson here. Dave Sirus,
Go
ahead.
You can go to Twitter.
Finish your thought.
I think that there's a difference in that no one likes Donald Trump and his cabinet. I don't think Pence likes him, and I don't think that he has any of the connections that Nixon had. I think Pence cannot wait to throw him under the bus. I think he denies him. I think he denies him the pardon because he wants to run for president.
Yeah, yeah. That's the only.
Trump's an outlier.
It's the only mass.
He's an insurgent.
It's the only mass transit Mike Pence believes in, the bus that he can throw Donald Trump under.
Yeah.
Wait.
I think.
Hang on. Let the applause die down. That's politically correct. All right. Dave,
I truly believe that.
How do people reach
all right,
you?
Man.
How do people reach you?
You go to Twitter /Dave Sirus, like virus, Sirus. Mm-hmm. And if you're in New York, I'll be at the New York Comedy Club this Thursday, this Sunday. Come hang out.
I will. I'll be there. I'll hang out. Thank you, buddy. Great job.
I'll be judging the roast battle on Thursday. Come by.
A week. Yes. That's great. Okay.
All right.
Thanks, buddy.
Later.
Bye.
Bye.
You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.